So AI is a very story-based perspective in that, as Jim just said, it's about tell me a time when you felt most proud about this or that. And when you build on those moments of pride, when you build on those moments of possibility, your story shifts. And rather than the, like you said, oh, it's me, oh, you know, it's, what can I do? The world's going to hell in a handbasket, you know?
Right.
Well, if that's where we, that's where we talk about, if that's the story we tell,
right,
how do you get out of that? On the other hand, if it's, remember when we thought we couldn't do this, but we did? And I know Jim's had some experiences, you know, just recently where he's seen this happen right in the moment.
Oh, absolutely.
Can you talk to us about that, how you've seen it work?
Well, we've used it in many cases, sometimes for a three-day executive strategy session where you're out in the woods and you're really trying to imagine a completely whole new way of taking your company to a completely other level. And sometimes it's just really in short conversations with, many times, you know, leaders of companies trying to imagine where they're going. And one company in particular was one of the nation's largest home builders. And they were just really wrestling with how can I possibly afford to do this green thing? And my gosh, our business is in such turmoil and it's dropping like a rock. And you know, isn't this a lefty, you know, wacko kind of a thing we're talking about? And some of the leaders were really skeptical and were really pushing off all these ideas. And once we helped them see, you know, the unintended, mostly negative consequences. I mean, this is not just a namby-pamby, the world was beautiful kind of thing. Once
right.
you understand those negative consequences, then you kind of push that off and you just start asking questions. When were you the most proud of your company? And interesting enough, sometimes it takes people a little while to really think of something because they're so focused in this problem-solving mentality. But once the stories start coming out, there was one story that came out of potentially one of the more skeptical people on the whole team that started talking about an extreme home makeover that they'd finally, you know, he had relented or acquiesced,
right.
Okay, we'll do this. The corporate people were saying we need to do this, and he thought it was going to be impossible to do, you know, this whole show in a 7-day period of time.
Right.
And what happened in the short order is when they actually got there, got on the scene from the film production side of it, they only had 3 days to do the work.
To build a home.
Mm-hmm. 3 days. They thought 7 was impossible. Okay? This is unbelievable. We can't possibly do it. Well, what happened? They did it.
Right.
They found a way. And
right.
then you could just see the whole energy of the room shift. And then when you dig in to say, okay, what did it take to make that impossible thing happen? You get these amazing stories of everyone rallying around a common cause, absolutely taking no, not taking no, for an answer, a big, hairy, audacious goal, impeccable
right.
planning and execution and intensity, and you get these stories, and you write them down on the wall, and you get capture all this. And then you just point from those examples of when you've done impossible things
right.
to these big, hairy environmental problems, and all of a sudden, they don't seem so impossible. We have done impossible things
right.
already. Let's just turn what we've already proven we can do to these challenges, and the creativity level, the energy level, the feeling that it's possible completely shifts in the room. And I think it has a very powerful opportunity for the whole sustainability agenda, and particularly how those stories that come out of the guts, the real, you know, meat of the organization, they are stories of who you are.
Right.
And when you can take those even from this strategy kind of conversation and pull those real authentic stories all the way into becoming a facet of your brand, that brand, those stories are completely authentic because they come from who you are, and that can create a more vibrant brand.
Well, and talk a little bit about how you turn that opportunity into execution. How do you execute on the opportunity that Appreciative Inquiry gives you? You know, you have the story, you pull the, like you said, you pull the guts of it out, you find this really beautiful little story, but how do you take what you have through that process and then turn it into a strategy that is actionable?
So if you look at the process of Appreciative Inquiry, it's called either the 5D, some people call it the 5D process, some people call it the 4D process, but regardless, the first thing is, what's the question? You know, what is the area of inquiry? The question that matters most to us, okay, that is posed to the organization.
Okay.
But then taking it through, as Jim just described, what we've really spent a little bit of time talking about here is that phase of discovery. Really thinking back to that time when were the most powerful, when you had tackled things that were impossible, or maybe even organizations that you've heard of or seen who are exemplars of sustainability.
Right.
Okay, so that's the first. So discovering
okay.
the best of who you are,
okay.
or the best of what you know. The second phase is the dreaming phase. when we ask people to really reach beyond what is probable, or excuse me, possible,
right.
to really look at what is possible, okay? The audacity to ask, what if?
Right.
As Jim's just talking about,
right.
What if?
Right.
So the first thing, discover. The second is dream. And the third thing is to design, okay? Dreams translated to execution. Get the plan. You know, we've seen certainly in our research that we've done that clear metrics,
right.
Then the ongoing reporting of those metrics in a very transparent way,
mm-hmm.
That allows people to, of course, measure their progress,
right.
but also provides that feedback.
Right.
Keep the pressure on, keep the tension on, okay?
Right.
So that execution, so you actually create a plan,
okay?
And then execute, do it, make it happen.
Okay.
Here's the key, though, Lisa, too, and I think that I just saw Jim do this, mm-hmm. It is not a point in time.
It is a process.
We often said, you know, in the work we did with Interface, is that it was a process, it was a journey.
Right.
And so what we see are these loops that are continuous,
right.
and I think that's the part that we look at with sustainability. I think we've heard it here all week, is that we're all figuring it out.
Right.
So what this does is it engages everyone in helping you figure it out. It's not, the people over here in the leadership group, or it's not the marketing people, but it's everybody coming together, diverse voices throughout the organization,
right.
who come together and say, together, when have we seen this company or this organization to do things we never thought was possible. Now,
right.
does this seem really that impossible?
Right.
No, it's not.
There's many times a lot of the traditional strategic planning skills will come into play here. But what we're doing is we're taking, stories of the best we've ever been, then imagining these, sometimes we call them provocative propositions.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So this amazing, state based on looking through the best we've ever been to some other amazing
mm-hmm.
state. And then perhaps doing traditional backcasting, really define what that looks like, and then step back in time from that. Okay, what do we have to do today, 2 years from now, 5 years from now, 10 years from now, to make that possible? And that's the designing phase of that. And then how do you continually refresh and done in the right way, based on these stories of the best that you've ever been, that tends to create a positive feedback loop
right.
that continues to energize itself
right.
instead of an old problem that you just have to keep pushing and pushing and pushing and pushing to keep it going. It picks up an energy of its own.
So the new achievements become a new part of the story.
Exactly.
And I find it really interesting that storytelling is becoming such a powerful
huge.
Tool. I mean, yesterday at the conference, the first day of the conference, it seemed like the big buzz that was going through was the whole idea of a North Star.
Yes.
Everybody
mm-hmm.
said something
yes.
about a North Star, that big goal, that really aspirational kind of vision, which is similar to what you're talking about, I
mm-hmm.
guess, is
part
using
of the process
to get you to maybe what your North Star is. And then today, I felt it was much more about the stories.
Mm-hmm.
It used to be that we would probably call them case studies, but they're more than that now because people inject themselves into them.
Absolutely.
And they clearly have taken it very personally, which I think is another thread that kind of runs through a conference like this, is that sustainability is a very personal to most of the people here.
It's absolutely, you're right there. But I don't want to discount, and Mona mentioned it before, it's very important to have numbers and facts
right.
and
yes.
figures. I mean, I'm a recovering chemical engineer, MBA.
Right.
So left brain, give me the numbers. But what do numbers help you do? They help you manage.
They help you manage, absolutely.
But stories help you transform.
Exactly.
And ignite and excite.
Numbers help you manage. Stories help you transform.
Yeah. And I think that's, and if you with something like this as big as it is, if you don't just engage with the mind, you've got to engage with the heart.
Right.
And so that's the
another
key.
Concept that is not always familiar in the corporate world.
It's changed. I think we're seeing this change. It's amazing.
Oh, there's an idea.
The whole idea of co-creation, the whole idea of this not just being, when we've seen Appreciative Inquiry also work really well, is that it's not just about the organization. It's a open system process where you're bringing in customers, you're bringing in suppliers. We talk about supply chain and greening supply chains. So it's not just the organization. It's
right. You're not cocooning. You're
exactly.
Really
it's an open system. And how do we get all of these people involved in this story to become what we want to become? And I think that's another thing that is a little bit different. I know when we talk sometimes to organizations, when we talk about bringing their customers into the conversation
right.
or suppliers, everybody's a little nervous.
Right.
But when you start explain to them that we're not going to sit here and talk about what's wrong.
Right. We're going to talk about what's
right. Because the moment you start talking about what's wrong, there's got to be somebody's fault.
There's blame. Mm-hmm.
When you start talking about what's right and what can be, heck, everybody wants to be part of a winner.
Right.
So we're going there together, you know, and that's, I think, the exciting part of all of this. Yeah. Okay.
But in our talk, we tried to do something completely different yesterday. Instead of the standard PowerPoint, you read the slides to everybody that puts everybody to sleep. And it was at 4 o'clock in the afternoon,
yes.
So it was a little tough.
We call that death by PowerPoint.
But we tried to give the audience a feeling of what this was before we even told them what it was. Mm-hmm. And
right.
We started the presentation with one of dozens and dozens of videos that is death and destruction, shame-ridden, the world's going to die, all this kind of stuff. And we asked people to write down 5 adjectives of what they were feeling.
Right.
And you got, guilt, shame. And then we got them to start telling stories with a partner, somebody they didn't know in the room,
right,
about stories of inspiring stories and what happened and what did it take to make those possible. And we got them involved. And as always, when you get people started, it's hard to shut them up so you can get
right
on with the program. But then we said, okay, let's list 5. Mm-hmm. You can write down 5 more objectives and share
adjectives.
It. Yeah. Hope, energy, expansiveness, creativity. Those were the kind of
right
concepts that came up. And you can just say, do you want to spend your time and do you think it's more effective to be in this world
right
or this world?
Right.
And that's how we started the presentation, to try to give folks a sense of the feeling for this, not an intellectual
right
lecture about
absolutely
what the theory was behind it. And I thought it was very effective, which, judging by the faces
right
and the level of energy.
You can feel the energy in a room if you've ever been in a room with a SWOT analysis,
mm-hmm,
right?
Yeah.
And it's very, and people say what they are expected to say to make sure that they control and take care of their own little world and,
right,
you know, that they look the best they can. On the other hand, when you start asking people to tell me a story about,
right,
you know, share some thoughts and ideas about, not the right answer, but just tell me about. Then what, from a academic standpoint, there's a thematic analysis that goes on, right? So through the stories, we see the key points, the key possibilities that then can be shaped into those okay strategies,
mm-hmm,
et cetera. So as Jim said, this is not so different
right
in what we're trying to get to. It's just the process.
It's the place that you start.
Yeah, the process. And another piece I think really important that we see is with sustainability, change has to occur at many, many levels.
Right.
As you do, I think you just
of
said,
course
it is both a personal journey
right
as well as an organizational journey.
Yes.
And I know we've both seen this, at least I'm sure you have too, that when people get involved in this,
yeah,
they don't leave it at the work door.
Oh, absolutely.
You've seen it.
Absolutely. Oh, I think that's so true. And then something that Ray Anderson is very likes to say is that he's never met a former environmentalist.
Oh.
Once people do get it,
that's right,
then it usually
like
stays
I call
with
the
them for
100
a long
doors
time
into sustainability. Everyone's shaped different for different factors that gets them engaged in it, but it's
right
only got one handle. You go through it, and it's being in California. It is Hotel California. They don't come back.
And so if we look at it and we say, okay, how do we shift the consciousness of the world,
right,
and can business be a benefit to the world, to change the world, to make it, see it differently? Well, if we start having these conversations inside the organization, and those conversations then go into the home
right
and with the kids, then business truly can be a powerful tool for shifting the conversation that's
right
going on out there. So obviously we're fired up about the process.
And it's all about sustainability. And sustainability is not, sustaining what we have now. It's sustaining our ongoing growth and development as humanity to create a better way. There's always a better way. So that's what we're trying to sustain, is that continued development, not sustain exactly the way we have life right now, because there's a lot of things we can work on.
Certainly, by changing the conversation.
Yeah.